Earth, what a great place to live. And there's a few reasons for that. The solar wind is deflected away by the Earth's magnetic field, so that's good. And the atmosphere, it's so thin, over two-thirds of the mass of it is below the height of Mount Everest. But even then, it shields us from harmful radiation and is responsible for the greenhouse effect, which is the main topic of this video. Hot things radiate out energy. Physicists call this blackbody radiation. And you know how something glows like blue or red hot? Like the sun has got a peak of its energy in the visible spectrum, and that's because its temperature is over 5,000 degrees. About 7% of the energy is in the UV, and nearly half of it is in the infrared. The Earth is also a blackbody, but it's obviously not as hot as the sun. So its peak wavelength is way off the charts, off to the right of the screen, at about 10 microns, so 10,000 nanometers. You can see some of the energy is absorbed on the way down by water vapor, especially, and oxygen, carbon dioxide, but mostly the sun gets through to the surface in clear air. The pressure is equal to the density times this constant times temperature. So pressure is very quickly equalized in the atmosphere. If you make a sound, you're making a pressure wave, and that's bouncing along and it's transmitted at the speed of sound. So any changes in pressure equalize out at the speed of sound. So the pressure inside and outside the hot air balloon is the same because you've got that hole in the middle there. And as you heat air, this temperature goes up. To keep the pressure the same, the density has to go down, so that makes it lighter. So that's why hot air balloons are buoyant and they can go up. If you calculated how much air there was sitting on a point, it's really the atmosphere is a big stacks on. And if you get the pressure at the surface, you divide it by the area to get force, and then you divide that by gravity to get mass, you come out with 10 tons of air over every square meter of land. So as you go up, because it's a stacks on, that gets less. There's less air pushing down on top of you. And you can use that to calculate your altitude. And pilots do this using the QNH, which is the pressure at the surface, and the pressure that they measure. The problem is you have to make some assumptions about the temperature. So what pilots use is this average here, called International Standard Atmosphere. And you can see that this is average, has it hottest at the surface, then it cools down to the tropopause, and then it heats up again. Now, it's hottest at the surface because the sun heats the surface, but why does it warm up again? That's because ultraviolet rays coming in reacts with oxygen to produce ozone, which not only protects us from sunburn, but it also makes this temperature inversion. And if you look at this image here, it's taken from the International Space Station at 400 kilometers high. It shows the top of the atmosphere is very flat. Now that's this inversion here at the tropopause, and because the air gets warmer, it means that any air rising up will just stop once it gets to this point, and that's what stops thunderstorms from developing out into space. Yeah, it does look like you're a bit lower here because the zoom from the camera, the photo taken from the satellite, but it's about four times the height of this page on the right on the graph. So I took this photo from Antarctica, and the cloud on the foreground is in shadow, but much higher up, this cloud is still in sun, and it's actually in the stratosphere. These clouds are associated with chlorofluorocarbons eating away the ozone layer. CFCs are also a really bad greenhouse gas, but there's only a small amount of them, 10 to the minus 10, whereas carbon dioxide is the most plentiful gas in dry air, after nitrogen, 80%, oxygen, 21%, and argon, nearly 1%. Having said that, it's only 400 parts per million, which is 0.04%. So out of that 10 tons, it makes up about 4 kilos. Now, with the density of air at the sea level being about 1.2 kilos per cubic meter, you're looking at 3.5 meters of carbon dioxide if you brought it all down to the surface. But you can see it's pretty evenly distributed throughout the atmosphere. Ozone, on the other hand, only comes to a few millimeters if you bring it down to the surface. And in a moment, I'll show you how much water vapor there is in comparison, but you can see it's mostly lower down. There's more of it lower down than there is carbon dioxide. And this graph shows that it's almost all around the tropics because warm air holds exponentially more water vapor. And as you get higher, it just gets much, much less. So 18 at the surface in the tropics, and as you get close to the poles, more like 1. That's an average over time, of course, because it varies a lot with the weather. So this is a heat budget for Earth. So you can see that the energy coming in, 341 watts, that's about 1,000 watts less than if you're facing directly at the sun, but it's averaged over day, night, summer, and winter. And of course, these values are averaged over land, clouds, and sea. If you have cloud, it's going to reflect a lot more sunlight, but cloud also has a strong greenhouse effect by keeping the energy going backwards and forwards between the Earth and the atmosphere. And you can see that is really quite a high amount here. So the greenhouse effect is really important. Without it, as soon as the sun went down, it would get extremely cold. It does that if you're a satellite and you go into shadow. Now, obviously, yeah, as I said, this is going to depend on the surface, but if you've got the sun more at an angle, it's going to shine through more atmosphere before it hits the surface. It might glance off and mostly reflect off the ocean, so the albedo or the reflectivity will change. But basically, we're looking at energy coming in from the sun, energy being reflected, and the outgoing longwave radiation. Now, because the temperature of the Earth is around about 300 Kelvin or 288 as an average, 15 degrees Celsius, the black body radiation is mostly centered around 10 or 11 microns, and we'll have a look at that in a moment. But yeah, this is the budget for Earth, and obviously it's highly variable on where you are. So the main greenhouse gas is actually water vapor. Now, this is the different wavelengths, and as I said, the peak for Earth is in here. So this window lets the heat escape out to space. If you're down here in 6 or 7 microns, this is where the satellite imagery looks at water vapor. We'll look at that in a moment. None of the energy from the surface gets through this layer. So the greenhouse effect blocks everything there, and it blocks everything here. So this here is where we have to leak out all that energy into space. And you can see carbon dioxide, even though it's basically taking a minority, it's in a pretty important position, like it's encroaching on this window. So it can have a varied influence, along with these other ozone and methane, other greenhouse gases. Clouds also make a big difference, and we'll look at the satellite image later to see how much energy is actually getting out to the satellite. So this is the albedo. 100% means that everything is reflective, so snow is very reflective, but with all these fires that we've had in Australia, a lot of the smoke and ash and also dust is settling on the snow, so it's making it a lot dirtier and it will melt quicker as soon as it stops flooding over there. And clouds, they vary. So depending on what type of cloud it is, it has a different reflectivity. So it actually turns out that if you have a cloud which has a high number of small water droplets, fog is an example of that, because there's lots of smoke and dust particles, it helps. Smoke is really small particles, so that helps fog formation because you get a high number of small droplets. That's really quite reflective. So some of the clouds have been made more reflective, and this has led to this cloud albedo effect, which is actually a net cooling influence. This is what the differences humans have made. So there's also a direct effect of aerosols having a shading effect, but they change clouds, they make them more reflective, and they make them last for longer. Also, changing from forest to crops increases the reflectivity, so that has a net cooling effect, and that's to do with this land use one, the albedo. But obviously the main warming effects are the greenhouse gases here. So this is a picture of fog. It's in late winter in Australia, near the coast. The coast is just over the back there. You've got clouds coming up off the coast, but it's more clear over the land. So what you want for fog, you're looking for moisture at the surface, light winds to gently mix it with, so you get a thin layer of moisture in the air rather than it all mixed out, so it just is not enough moisture it gets mixed through. If it gets mixed into the dry air, then it's gone, but if you mix it just a little bit, you can form that fog. But you also want a nice cold surface. Obviously it's more common at winter and during the night is when it forms. So to get good cold surface cooling, it helps to have a really dry atmosphere, because that means all the energy can be radiated out from the surface and it doesn't get reflected back to the earth by clouds or an atmosphere rich in water vapor. Also, if you're high in the mountains, it gets really cold at night because you don't have, and it's a clear night, then it'll get pretty cold pretty quickly. So now I'm going to check out some spreadsheets to show you. So the greenhouse effect, let's pretend it doesn't exist, because then it makes maths really easy and you can just think about blackbody radiation. So the temperature of the earth, there's a relationship between the energy radiated out and the temperature. As you increase the temperature, you multiply by the fourth power to figure out how much energy comes out from the earth. So it's very sensitive. The earth at the same time collects energy from the sun, just as if it were a disk. And you can do this calculation in about half a page. So I've done it in this spreadsheet using the insolation and the accepted albedo value of 31% being reflected off, especially clouds, ice, and anything shiny. And that gives us a temperature that the Earth would be expected to be of minus 19 degrees on average. But that's about 33 degrees cooler than what we observe. So to get the same kind of effect, if we had no greenhouse gas and we had a brighter sun, we'd bring that up to 2,222 watts, not quite double, to get that same effect. So it's pretty remarkable how much difference it makes. And if you're thinking about the albedo, if we made it 0%, which effectively means the sunlight during the day gets completely absorbed by the ground, so it's actually dark because none of it gets reflected towards your eyes, then it's still not as warm. It's 9 degrees cooler than it is with the greenhouse effect. Right, so here's some balloon soundings, so it shows the temperature profile. If we look at Darwin, you can see this precipitable water is 48 millimeters. That means that if you get a square meter of surface, you've got 48 liters or 48 kilos on the ground. So compare that to carbon, which is about 4 kilos. And you can see there's quite a lot of surface moisture in Darwin. But if you go further south to, Perth, we can see that we're looking at more like 14, 15, and these values vary a lot with the weather. So let's have a look at what the weather's doing. Firstly, the water vapor imagery. So if you can see something really bright, that means the top of the water vapor is quite high. So these storms coming out here. But where it's dark, you can see deeper into the atmosphere. So the upper part of the atmosphere is really dry in the dark areas. Now, let's get the satellite imagery running. So this is the infrared. So this is looking at the heat around 10 microns, maybe 12 microns, that's coming from clouds. It's obviously very hot in the tropics, but the heat is going up, it's hitting the cloud, and the cloud's acting like a blanket, and all that heat is going back down again, because what we see from the satellite is white. It's quite cold. On the other hand, the hottest part of this whole image, the black part, is where the sun is shining into the Australian desert. You can even see it moving across, and that's getting... most of that is radiating back towards the satellite because there's only a small amount of cloud cover blocking it and the atmosphere is quite dry. Now, if we change to the visible imagery, like, let me tell you, like, you can't really of the oceans and the tops of the clouds basically stays the same day and night, so you can't see any sun moving across here. But contrast that to the visible, and you can see the sun moving across quite easily. And this here should really be pitch black. They've just put some infrared there. If I change it back, look at the dark area, and you can see that it's basically the same. So day and night, it radiates out heat because it's just dependent on the temperature. But during the day, solar radiation comes in, and a lot of it is reflected back. We're looking at what's reflected back, and a lot of it is absorbed by the surface, and that turns into heat, which is later radiated out or bounces up against the greenhouse layer and clouds. So it's a complex system, there's a lot going on, but there's some simple principles which tie it all together.